Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
So I've called this jealousy, enviously, covetous. Jealously, enviously, covetous. Sometimes we get caught up maybe in the semantics and we think that one is better or worse than another. And yet, oftentimes when we do that, we're probably just trying to downplay our own sin. But Isaiah 5 and verse 20 says, "Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil." And so we've got to be careful of trying to minimize what God considers to be sinful. We read this account over in Luke chapter 16 and verse 14 and 15, where it says that the Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard all these things. And so we know that the Pharisees, the leaders of the Jews, had a critical spirit, and they were envious. They were envious of Jesus. They were covetous. It says here that in verse number 10, "For he knew that the chief priests had delivered him for envy," And I don't know. Sometimes people get the idea that envy and jealousy are the same. I've looked up some of the definitions of it, and I want to get overly involved in it. But while many people believe that jealous means fearing someone who will take what you have, and envious means desiring what someone else has, I guess both could be considered covetous behaviors. And I think that's true overall. I think there is a tendency for us to become possessive of that which we cherish, whether it's an individual or possession of sorts, and we're jealous in that sense. But then there's this envy when we see something that somebody else has, and we ourselves, our own stinking flesh, wants to desire what they have. So I can see a little bit of a difference between the two here, but I'm just trying to figure out, because in my reading recently, I was reading an account in the Old Testament about a couple of individuals, and it came through my mind that sometimes we are jealous or envious or covetous of what someone else has or possesses, and I think we're out of place when we do it. I think it's unnecessary. I think we sometimes sell ourselves short. So you have to remember this, that the Lord knows who and what he got when he saved us. And when he calls us to serve, whatever the capacity may be, we need to learn that he knows who he called. He knows the gifts, the talents, the abilities that we possess at the time, and he wants to use that. If he was just trying to create a cookie cutter workforce, if you will, then he would just create them. He did that with the angels a long time ago. But we're all individuals, and God is using us. He's working on us, and we're all in the development stage. So I was looking at these thoughts about along that line, and I began to think of why someone would be jealous, envious, covetous of someone else and what they were doing, or something else, or what God was doing with someone else, and trying to, mosey on in to what they were doing. And so let me just give you a few things here as I was looking at. I looked up the word jealous in all of its forms in the Bible, and it appears 54 times in 43 verses. I looked up the word envy in all of its forms, and it appears 41 times in 40 verses. So there's a similar amount of instances in the Bible. But I have to tell you this, that envy, And I looked over it. I didn't tear all the verses apart, but just did a casual glance through all the verses that deal with envy. Envy is never a good thing. Envy is never anything that's used in a positive sense. Now, we may use the term that way, but that doesn't make it right. Envy is more associated with greed and covetousness. And yet, jealousy can be used in both ways. Jealousy can be something that is, well, favorable or unfavorable. And so, like I said, as it relates to envy, Proverbs 14:30 says, the sound heart is the life of the flesh, but envy is the rottenness of the bones. As you can clearly see, in God's estimation, envy is rotten. Rotten to the core. James 3 in verse 16, the Bible says, where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. And so you can't separate envy from wickedness, envy from evil. And but like I said, on the other hand, jealousy can be a good thing, a positive thing. And many of the verses that incorporate jealousy have to do with perhaps a husband's desire for his wife, and even to the extent where God looks at Israel and her worship and all in an envious way. As a matter of fact, the Bible says in Exodus 34 and verse 14, "For thou shalt worship no other god, for the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God." So clearly there is time for jealousy to be used in a positive sense, to be possessive of something that is valued and cherished, loved and appreciated. And even the Apostle Paul, for that matter, went that way as it related to the church. He said in 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 1 and 2, "Would to God ye would bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me, for I am jealous over you with godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ." And so I was looking in our text here, and it clearly says that the chief priests, the elders, the Pharisees, the religious leaders, they delivered Jesus out of, well, it says in our text, out of envy. Envy, because of the way that it's utilized in the Word of God, envy is not a good thing. Howbeit, let me just simply say this, that the chief priest did have plenty to be envious of when it came to compare themselves with Jesus. They had loads to be jealous of, and they had lots to be covetous of, because on their best day, they couldn't compete, they couldn't compare with Jesus Christ. Let me also say, on the flip side of that, on Jesus's worst day, as the Son of God, he was still head and shoulders above them. And 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 25 says, "Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men." And that's true, not that God is foolish or that he is weak, but if there were any chinks in his armor, and there are not, he would still be far above, far beyond whatever man has possessively and what he could ever accumulate. God's ways are not our ways, neither are his thoughts our thoughts. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so are his ways higher than our ways, and his thoughts than our thoughts. And so we're on a different wavelength altogether. So you can see that if you're going to try to compare yourself in any particular fashion to Jesus Christ, you might be, I'll just say, a little envious of what he has. They would say things about him like, "No man speaketh like this man. We've never seen it on this wise." Because we've never seen anything like Jesus Christ. And he was very God in the flesh. He was a God-man, and no one else has ever been like that. And he is something to be, well, the Christian is to model their life, to attempt to fashion their existence like Jesus Christ. So I understand that. But what about each other? What about when we look at each other? I mean, some people have been saved a year, some people have been saved 50 years, some people are, we'll say, in more advanced stages of spiritual learning than others. Some, for whatever reasons, have not grown sufficiently, and to someone else. And when we look at that, we feel, I don't want to say slighted, but we feel like we come up short a little bit. And sadly enough, because we all have this stinking flesh, what we end up doing is we become, as we're talking tonight about, jealous, we become envious, we become covetous. But is that a good thing? I mean, it's one thing, like I said, to envy Jesus. It's another thing to envy each other, because when those kinds of things set in, it tends to lead to behaviors that are rather unbecoming. Matter of fact, Paul said in 2 Corinthians 10 and verse 12, "For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise." Are not wise. And I would imagine, if you were to look at someone that you, in your estimation, felt as though they were much more spiritual than you, and you desired to put in the hard work and dedication in order to advance your Christian life, I think that would be a good thing. But, you know, many people are envious of what someone else has, and they're just unwilling. They're unwilling to put in the time and the effort in order to get to that level. Another confession on my part. I've been playing the guitar since I was, 7 years old at all. But for the most part, most of my guitar playing was done to accompany singing. And so I did that throughout my life. And to a degree of satisfaction of myself and listeners, I suppose. And I would always have this, and I've only kind of grown to know this over the years, I'd always have this, as I'm talking about tonight, this envy or jealousy or whatever word you want to use, over those who were great guitarists or great individuals that excelled with an instrument. And I would think to myself, I would even say at some point, boy, I wish, if I could only play the guitar like that. And then I realized I could, if I was willing to put in the time and the effort that some of these individuals have put in, I could play like that. But the fact that I haven't chosen to do that is the reason why I don't excel to that level. The same is true in the spiritual realm. You know, we can look at someone and say, man, they're spiritual. Boy, they can pray. Boy, they can witness. They can do all of these things. And we look at that and we say, boy, if I could only do that. Well, you can. You can. And we're looking maybe for a means of escape by justifying our lack of ability on their success. And the reason I say all of this is because, as I mentioned, I was reading and I encountered an individual in the Old Testament, and this subject matter kind of popped up. And it was between Saul and David. Between Saul and David. And the passage, and it's kind of a song, if you will, that's presented in the Bible back in 1 Samuel. The lyrics are the telling part. And so let me read first in 1 Samuel 18 in verse 6 to 9. It says, it came to pass when David was returning from the slaughter of the Philistine, great success on the part of David, killing Goliath there. And it says that the women came out of all cities of Israel, singing and dancing to meet King Saul. Pay attention to that. They come out for David. They came out to meet King Saul. How'd they do that? With tabrets, with joy, with instruments of music. And the woman answered one another as they played and said, Saul hath slain his thousands. Now, if they'd have just simply, like a lot of modern Christian music, just kept repeating the same line over and over again, maybe Saul would have been happy as a lark. But the second phrase, the second stanza here, Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000s. Ooh, Saul didn't care for that too much. And it says, and Saul was very wroth, and the saying displeased him. The lyrics to the song displeased him. And he said, they have ascribed unto David 10,000, and to me they've ascribed but thousands. He felt, think about it. Saul had actually been responsible for slaying in battle thousands. Is that an accomplishment or not? I mean, if you were a returning war hero, and you had, I mean, I think this would get you maybe the Congressional Medal of Honor. I think you might even become, next to Sergeant York and any others from days gone by, whatever heroes you might want to look up to. I think Saul would be there. But for whatever reason, the fact that someone took note of David's 10,000, somehow in the mind, the estimation of Saul just destroyed all that he had ever accomplished. As a matter of fact, it goes on and says, they have ascribed unto David 10,000, and to me they've ascribed but thousands, and what can he have more but the kingdom? I mean, his mind begins to just run away with him. Now, it's not only does he feel slighted over the fact that he hasn't done as much as David, but now he's envisioning that David will probably want to take his kingdom from, by the way, Saul's the king. And it says there in verse number 9, and Saul eyed David from that day forward. He kept his eye on David. David hadn't done anything. As a matter of fact, if you know the life and the goings on between Saul and David, you know that David was an upstanding guy. I mean, he had opportunity time and again to take out Saul and didn't. Would not touch the Lord's anointed. And yet, when those that did, he took them to task. But notice, all of this is taking place. All of this seems to me, anyway, to be stemming from a spirit of jealousy or envy on the part of Saul, which literally dismantled all his accomplishments in life. We go down a little further in 1 Samuel 21, and it says in verse 10 to 12, and David arose and fled that day for fear of Saul and went to Achish, the king of Gath. And the servants of Achish said unto him, is not this David the king of the land? Did they not sing one to another of him and dances, saying, Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000s? And David laid up these words in his heart and was sore afraid of Achish, the king of Gath. A little further on down in the in the book, 1 Samuel 29 and verse 5 and 6, they said, "Is not this David, of whom they sang one to another in dances, saying, Saul slew his thousands and David his 10,000s? Yes, it became well known, but they weren't taking away. They weren't saying, "Boy, that's Saul, what a bum he is. He could only kill 1/10 of what David did." No, they were singing the praises of both Saul and of David. Hey, David in his, and who would ever figure it? Saul is from the fighting tribe of Benjamin. But David is just, he's a shepherd boy. Who would have ever expected it? But yet, David, because of his spiritual connection with the Lord, was able to rise up and do the things that anyone could do if they would just simply trust God. Saul's demise was not really David's doing. Saul's demise was not even the Lord's doing. Saul's demise was in his own mind. He saw himself. As a matter of fact, I was thinking about this. If you remember when the children of Israel sent out representations into Canaan land, when they went in there to spy out the land and they came back and gave their report, it was the strangest thing because Joshua and Caleb, they were of the opinion like, "Let's hurry up. Let's get down there right away. This is ours for the taking." But the other 10 representatives of the tribes came back and they said, "Oh, we can't do this. There's giants down there, you know, lions and tigers and bears." And they said something about the way that, because they looked at the giants and saw them, then and responded that way, the giants looked back at them and considered them to be but grasshoppers. And they said, "And so we were," in their sight. In other words, because their estimation of them was nothing, that's the way they envisioned themselves. "Oh no, we can't do this, we're nothing." Rather than to realize that God has already given them the charge to go there and take the land. So it is here with Saul. Saul is a great man. Saul means asked for or demanded. If you recall the way that this goes down, for whatever reason, the children of Israel were not overly happy with a theocracy, and so they wanted to be like all the other nations. They wanted to have a king over them. And God told Samuel, "Don't worry about it, Samuel. You tell them, though, that when they get a king, this is what they're going to get." And he described for them what an earthly king would be like. But I say all this to simply say that the people chose Saul. He was the people's choice. He had a pedigree. In 1 Samuel 9 and verse 1 and 2, the Bible said, "Now there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish." This is Saul's daddy. "The son of Abiah, the son of Zer, of the son of Becherath, the son of Aphiah, a Benjamite, a mighty man of power." That's what they were known for. "And he had a son whose name was Saul, a choice young man." Notice the way he's described here, a choice young man and a goodly. "And there was not among the children of Israel a goodlier person than he. From his shoulders and upward, he was higher than any of the people." He appeared on GQ cover. He was something. He was something that the general population took note of. They respected him. They felt as though his credentials, his pedigree was sufficient enough for him to be their leader. And he wasn't like strutting his stuff. He didn't feel as though that he was the cat's meow. In 1 Samuel 9 and verse 21, it says that Saul answered and said, "Am not I a Benjamite of the smallest of the tribes of Israel, and my family the least of the families of the tribe of Benjamin? Wherefore then speakest thou so to me?" Like, what are you coming to me for? I mean, I'm a nobody. My family's a nobody. I'm from the smallest tribe in Israel. It's like, he wasn't humble. God resisteth the proud, but he giveth grace to the humble. And Saul here is spiritually anointed. He's anointed by Samuel to go and to lead the people. Matter of fact, God, if you think about it, God may not have specifically chosen him, but he put a stamp of approval on him. He said to Samuel, "Yeah, go down and anoint him." Ultimately, David becomes his replacement, but that's only because of Saul's doing, because Saul began to do things that, well, probably ought not to have done. But the Spirit of God came upon Saul, and whose doing do you think that was? Clearly, God is the one that anointed him to do that. But no man of the Bible had as many chances for success than Saul. And at the same time, there probably isn't as a whole lot of people that have not got to a place where they squandered, they missed out on all of their opportunities. Saul, as I said, he was the people's choice. And God allowed Samuel to anoint him as king, but his self-will, his insecurity, his partial obedience gave way to David becoming his replacement. Saul didn't have to be a failure. He could be, very well could be, in Hebrews chapter 11, but he's not. I checked, and just to be sure, Saul is not in Hebrews chapter 11 in the Hall of Fame. Jealousy and envy of David's success gave him a sense of failure. And because of that, it was in his mind. That's why Romans 12 says that we're supposed to be renewed in the mind. He said, "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." We got to start thinking, if God called us, he's going to equip us. And we don't have to compare ourselves to what anybody else is doing.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows: Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m., Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m., and again at 6 p.m., and our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code